The line with us right now is Professor Richard Wolff, the economist, the co-founder of democracyatwork.info, the author of numerous books. His latest book is The Sickness is the System, When Capitalism Fails to Save Us from Pandemics or Itself, also available as an e-book. R.D. Wolff with 2Fs.com, also his website. Prof. Wolff, P-R-O-F-W-O-L-F-F is his Twitter handle. Professor Wolff, welcome back. We keep bouncing this word neoliberalism around, and it's like the movement that has no name. I'm wondering if you can just lay down a straightforward explanation of what neoliberalism is, where it came from, and why we should care about it.
Okay, I'd be glad to. The confusion is particularly strong here in the United States because we use the word liberal in a different way from the way, for example, they do that in England or in most of Europe. In those parts of the world, liberal means the opposite of government intervention. It's what we would call private enterprise or a privatized economy, an economy in which the government's economic interventions are minimized or, in the more extreme formulations, absent altogether. So you might say the opposite of liberal in that language, in that kind of English, is the notion of Keynesian economics or active ongoing state intervention. So what then is neoliberalism? Well, it's really a term that came into vogue around the 1970s. And it came into vogue with the ascendancy of Margaret Thatcher in England and Ronald Reagan in the United States. That was thought, particularly by them, to be a great turning point in America after the legacy of the Great Depression and the New Deal had worn off. In other words, in the era of the 1930s, of the Great Depression, the basic idea was that private capitalism had collapsed and the government had been called in to rescue private capitalism with unemployment insurance, the social security system, government hiring, minimum wages, lots of governmental active economic intervention. And that was the dominant view of how the modern capitalism would have to work from about 1931, 32, all the way to Thatcher and Reagan, that is, the 70s, so almost half a century. Then, the story goes, this petered out. This approach of government intervention left a lot of people unsatisfied, not just the business community, although they were the most upset, but other people, too, who felt that inflations and stagnations were also part of it. So there needed to be a change. And the right wing really took the bit between its lips and ran with it and developed an alternative. And they literally stood the old Keynesian New Deal idea on its head. Instead of the private economy being the problem and the government is the solution, they reversed it. Everything in the economy that doesn't work well, they blamed on the government. And the entire solution would be what was variously called privatization or minimizing the government or getting the government off our backs. It was literally the opposite for the last 40 years of what you had had for the previous 40 years. And it got the name neoliberalism, the return to a supposedly great situation where the government would be getting out of our hair and we would return to the glories and wonders of private enterprise, private markets, let the corporations do whatever they need and want to do because the pursuit of profit by business is the royal road to prosperity and growth for all of us. And a key part of that came to be globalization. The idea that the globe should be remade, the world economy remade by profit-driven corporations, all of them private, and governments should simply get out of the way and let the wonders of the market unfold. With the collapse, the crash of 2008, and now again the crash of 2020, a crash that happened even before COVID. Now you see that we're probably at a switch point again where all of the criticisms leveled at government economics in the 70s is now being levied against this neoliberal phase. And so you even have people like Paul Krugman and others who were once enamored of the privatization neoliberalism changing and going back to seeing an important set of roles for the government.
So, you know, in the Warren Harding, when he was elected in 1920, his two campaign slogans were a return to normalcy, and by that he meant dropping the 91% top tax rate that had been put in place because of World War I. And he did that. He took it down to 25%. And more government in more business in government, less government in business, which was basically what you just described, right? To reduce the role of government and government regulation. That kicked off the Roaring Twenties, although there is an argument to be made that the Roaring Twenties was also kicked off by the end of the flu epidemic. I think we understand that better now, having been through COVID. And it led right straight to the crash of 1929. And that was, at that point, everybody kind of abandoned that theology and embraced Keynesianism, you know, FDR and Keynesianism. Did that have a name back then? We call it neoliberalism now. And was it essentially the same thing? Or because back then we had, I think the average tariff on imported goods in the United States was well north of 20%, maybe even as high as 30%. Which is very different from now. How do these eras compare?
I think, Tom, your question answers itself. I can't answer your question. Good question. I don't know of any overarching term equivalent to neoliberalism. Certainly it wasn't neoliberalism then, but the reality is we've all forgotten. We don't know our history. It's important that you bring to our attention that this is, in a way, nothing new, that the war is a time when the government realizes, uh-oh, we better not stick it to the mass of people quite as badly as we have before, otherwise we won't have a unified country and we'll lose the war. So they do a few things, like upping taxes on the rich and on corporations, but as soon as the war is over, assuming that they've won it, they quickly undo what they just did, and you can see it again in 1945. The World War II is over. They can, in one fell swoop, they can get rid of Roosevelt, they can get rid of the New Deal, and they can get rid of all the wartime steps that they took. Only now, because there was an admixture of professors, perhaps, in a way that there wasn't in Harding's time, all of it gets glorified into an ism, neoliberal ism, to raise it up to something that they can claim to be historical. But you bring us right back with your question to the real hard ground that this is pretty old cheese, what we're watching here, including the fact that within a few years after you deregulate, because that's what neoliberalism loves to talk about, deregulate, get the government out, within a few years, I mean, I like to use this example. In 1999, Bill Clinton signs the repeal of the Glass-Steagall Act, the banking act that was passed in 1933 to control the terrible impact on our depression of what banks did. The banks fight it. By 1999, they get the Democratic president to sign off on repealing it. And 9 years later, the economy experiences the worst crash since the 1930s. I mean, you need a playwright to write a script, and if they did, it would be considered to be a little bit mechanical the way this thing has been rerun on us.
Yeah. So where do we go from this? I mean, this epidemic of neoliberalism has moved at least $7 trillion out of the pockets of the middle class into the top 1%. We've seen our power systems and water systems privatized and giant monopolies created to the point that, you know, our power systems can't deal with floods and hurricanes. And I mean, it's just we've got this disaster as a result of this 40-year experiment with neoliberalism, or maybe you could call it Reaganism. How do we get out of this?
Well, I think the first thing is to make a recognition that few people have been willing to make, which is a little bit, and this may separate us from one another a moment. You got to recognize that the problem isn't this or that phase of the capitalist system, the one with more government, the one with less government. We've been there. We've tried that. We've tried more. We've tried less. The reason they lead into one another is that neither of them is adequate to the problems we have. Here's my fear.
To the problem of capitalism.
That's right.
We have just one minute, by the way, until a hard break. Sorry.
Right. My fear is that we're going to now have a period of renewed government intervention. You can see it with Joe Biden and many of the things that he's doing. It will help the situation. It'll be better for the mass of people than what you would have had under Reaganism or neoliberalism, for sure, just as the New Deal was a much better deal for working people than what had gone on in the 1920s. But it doesn't solve basic problems. That's what happened in the 1970s. That's what turned it all over. No more Great Society of Lyndon Johnson. No more a New Frontier of Mr. Kennedy. It all collapsed into Trumpism and all the rest of it. And my fear is if we don't learn that the problem goes deeper than the oscillation between a bit more and a bit less, if we don't finally engage the question of the system itself, we will be on the pendulum swing, which is not going to be a happy place to be, particularly given the greater problems of the U.S. economy today than what we had before.